All of this is for us to rise, for us to rise and to live from one glad surprise, rise, glad surprise, rise, glad surprise. So we're constantly being surprised by the presence of God bringing forth mighty miracles, magnificent unfoldment, great evolution, so much in our life. And it's always a surprise because it's always outside of our present paradigm. The blessings that we are inviting into our life through affirmative prayer, meditation, life visioning, study, and fellowship, we always think we know what we want. But what we want is often defined within our own paradigm that we're already living in. We think we know what we want based on what's already here and what we've already experienced. But oftentimes the blessing that is for us is outside of our present paradigm. It's in the realm of the unknown. And it surprises us when it shows up in our lives. A greater sense of peace, greater opportunities and possibilities showing up that we didn't even know were there. Or perhaps we knew they were there, but we just couldn't see them at the time. And so we invite you to enter into this sacred service with an awareness that you're in a dogma-free zone, and that our only desire and hope is that you discover yourself, that you find yourself, you find the infinite potential that lies within you, and that you set it free. So that your time on planet Earth, your time in human incarnation, is a time by which you're bringing forth the glory of the living God. You're bringing forth that which is immortal, that which is eternal, that which is forever, that which is timeless through you, as only you can do it and be it. Therefore, we're inviting you this month to come to an understanding that you are the alchemist of your own life. You're the alchemist of your own life. What is alchemy? You know, we've heard down through the ages that an alchemist is an individual that transmutes lead to gold. They're able to take that particular base metal and begin to send it through an alchemical process of transformation that allows what was once lead to be gold. Now, we've come to know mystically that it means that we are to be the alchemists of our own life, that is, taking areas of our own life that are leaden or dead, obstructions and hindrances and problems and issues, and to transform those leaden places within our own life into a golden hue of possibility that shows up that we didn't even know what was possible at that particular moment. To take that which was lead and turn it into gold in our own life. Now, the secret of alchemy is this. In order for an alchemist to transmute lead to gold, there has to be a little bit of the frequency of gold available. It has to be some vibration of the very thing that we want that has to exist already. So the alchemist takes a piece of gold, regardless of how minuscule, uses that to up-level the vibration and the frequency of lead until the lead up-levels to gold. The same thing in our own life. We have to take a bit of the frequency of what we want to see in our life, pay undistractable attention to it, become interested in it, and then fan that spark into a holy flame until our life becomes golden with that particular quality. Now, in the mind of the infinite, there isn't a quantity, there's only quality. Because the Spirit of God is infinite, omnipresent, everywhere. There's nothing outside of the infinite. So there's no quantity in God because God is everywhere. And creation, God is not merely in creation, creation is in God. God surrounds and cradles all creation, but as Ernest Holmes reminds us, it never absorbed by its creation, infinite. So God only sees quality. So we're inviting ourselves through the alchemical process to take a frequency of what we want in our life, to fan it into a holy flame, to pay attention to it, and you become aware little by little by little, sometimes dramatically, sometimes incrementally, that that quality of the presence is infinite, everywhere present, until it begins to turn the dull places in our life into a glowing golden hue that reveals itself as infinite potential, infinite possibilities. And then we discover that all along the way, the presence of those qualities, that essence of God, has always been here. It was not hiding from us. It was not playing hide and go seek. Our attention was in the interestingly wrong place. Our attention was on what we don't like. Our attention was on what we're trying to get rid of. Our intention was on what we're resisting. Our intention was on obstacle and hindrance and obstruction. And we're being given the opportunity as metaphysicians to begin to hone our attentive prowess, that we're interested in the gold. We're interested in the golden hue. We're interested in that higher frequency, so that it continues to magnify and express itself in every area of our life. You are an alchemist of your own life. When you begin to be aware that you are the alchemist of your own life, you come out of being a victim of circumstance. You become out of being a victim to the facts of your life, which are the coagulated thought forms, opinions, points of view, positionalities previously held that have condensed themselves into time and space so that you may be under siege by facts, under siege by condensed perceptions. And but we're asking you to find just a little tiny bit of the frequency that you want to experience. Place your attention there, pray from there, affirm from there, proclaim from there, decree from there, announce from there, ultimately live from there, so that that little bitty thing, which is everywhere, by the way, becomes your perception of how you see life. And then the facts of life begin to transmute themselves, because the facts of your life are merely the past. They are the past masquerading as your present moment. They are the artifact of a previously held point of view. So in a moment of insight and revelation, you stop identifying with the ego and you start identifying with your soul. The ego is a compilation of positionalities that are held together by vanity and by fear. That's what the ego is. It's just a compilation of positionalities. You know, you see life this way, you see life with this perspective, you have this opinion, this point of view, and then vanity and fear holds it all together. Why? Because the ego cannot see into the unknown. It doesn't know enlightenment, awakened consciousness. It thinks all of that means annihilation. Not for you. It means annihilation. And so it holds everything together in terms of positionality, trying to protect your present point of view. You don't get rid of the ego, but you stop identifying with it as your calling. You stop identifying with it as the director of your life. You stop identifying it as the great reactor to circumstances. And something else begins to open up in your awareness. You are an alchemist. That's what you're doing here, you see. And so in that awareness, you begin to be aware that you are to be loyal to your own soul. Loyal to your soul. You are a living soul that has made pre-incarnational choices before you arrived on the planet Earth. This soul is a multidimensional aspect that transcends time and space, and it carries a calling, it carries a choice, it carries a genius capacity, and you are to be loyal to your own soul. And so you want to ask yourself, are you being loyal to your soul? I mean, there's a soul to a nation, there's a soul to a neighborhood, you know, there's a subjective vibrational frequency to the world. And many people are operating or being pulled on the puppet strings of others' agendas, not being loyal to their own soul, you see? I was thinking earlier of a Dr. Howard Washington Thurman, who spoke to the voice of the genuine that is within us. And he talked about the fact that we are to ultimately listen to, hear, and follow the voice of the genuine. And he goes on to say that if in fact you do not find and uncover and live by the voice of the genuine, you will live your entire life on the strings that somebody else is pulling. The voice of the genuine is another way of saying being loyal to your own soul. He goes on to say that if you hear the voice of the genuine and do not obey, you will wish that you were never born. Powerful. Once you hear it and you begin to feel the voice of the genuine within you and you don't listen and obey, you will wish that you were never been born, because you can't unsee what you've seen, you can't unhear what you have heard. And so in this awareness, as you begin to listen, as you begin to pray from this deep respect, if I'm going to be loyal to my own soul, I'm going to be loyal to my own soul. You begin to be aware, and I want you to hear this, that there is a genius in you. Really, you may not think you're a genius. You may have been captured by the limited point of view of genius being high IQ according to some interpretation of numbers and abstract signs and things of that particular nature, how they measure IQ. You may have been fooled by that kind of nonsensical awareness of what a genius is, you see? But everyone has genius. Everyone has gift. Everyone has something. It was Albert Einstein that said, in substance, that if a fish were to judge itself by how well it could climb a tree, it would think of itself as stupid for its entire life. You have a genius in you. And so when you're loyal to your soul, you want to begin to ask, what is my genius? Not how can I fit into the world. What is my genius? Not how I can fit into the soul of my school that I went to, or the soul of my neighborhood. What is my loyalty to my soul? What does that mean? What is the voice of the genuine? What is my genius capacity within me? And then that becomes the foundational piece of your strength. You walk out into the world on your strength, not mimicking or copying other people, their strength, you know. You're not trying to climb a tree if you're a fish. You're not trying to swim to the depth of the ocean if you're a bird. You're following your calling. You're following what your strength is. You are being loyal to your own soul. And that genius within you begins to emerge. And the thing about it is, sometimes your genius doesn't feel all that much to you. Because it is your strength, it seems to come. You uncover the obstacles and the fears and the hindrances and the shyness about it. And it doesn't feel like it's all that to you. And then people say, oh my God, how did you do that? How did you pull that off? How did you start that business? How did you do that class? How did you raise so much money? How do you, and you're like, what are you talking about? It was just kind of easy for me. I just kind of just felt into it. And see, your genius is so close to you, you don't even think it's genius. You see? So you want to begin to ask yourself, what is my genius? You see? This is the loyalty to your own soul that keeps you from dangling on the strings that somebody else is pulling. I was sharing earlier, I was having a conversation with a gentleman who said he woke up when he was being deployed to as a soldier somewhere, and he was there, and suddenly he became aware that he didn't know why he was there. He had just followed instructions his whole life, you know, ROTC, signing up for the service. Next thing you know, he was in war. He had no idea why he was there. None of it made sense, the things that were going on. He realized that he was being pulled by the strings of somebody else's agenda. And he woke up over there. Now he's an activist for peace and love and harmony and generosity, feeding people, doing some issues around the homeless. But when he heard the voice of the genuine within himself, he realized that he had not been loyal to his own soul. He had been loyal to something else. What is our genius? And then something else begins to emerge when we're loyal to our own soul. We stop trying to change other people. In our minds, in our actions, in our manipulation. That's no longer our full-time job. We shift our perception about individuals. Each and every individual is an immortal, eternal being. On the journey of unfoldment to become connected consciously with the Christ presence within them. When you read the Bible, you know, metaphysically, there's many ways to read it. You know, you can read it from the culture of the Aramaic language. You can read it metaphysically. There's so many, you know, one thing you don't want to read it as just like full-on history because you get in trouble that way, you know, or literal. Woo, if you're literalist, God bless you. But anyway, metaphysically, we understand that the characters in the Bible represent states of consciousness. And that you go through a doorway through these particular states where you finally end up in the Jesus consciousness, the Christed nature of your soul. You know, you go through Moses, you go through Abraham, you go through Esther, you go through all these particular states that represent states of being that ultimately lead you to redemption, ultimately lead you to a divine connection with who and what you really are, your soul faculty, the Christ consciousness. And in that same sense, when you stop trying to change other people, you can look out in the world and instead of petrifying people based on what they said or have done in their life, you see states of consciousness instead. And you see people passing through different states of consciousness, and you become aware that they are not that state. They are passing through that particular state. So non-judgmental awareness begins to emerge, and you use your imaginal skill to begin to talk to a higher state within them. And therefore, you become a causal blessing to individuals' unfoldment and inspiration because you're not dealing with them mentally and vibrationally as stuck in a state. You are dealing with them as an eternal, immortal being, and in your imagination, and then ultimately your soul faculty is activated, and you actually see the being as they are, not just identifying them with the state, and then petrifying them there the entire time so that 2 or 3 years later, you still see them the same way, react the same way in your mind because you never know. An angel of God may have kissed them in the night and they may have begun a transformation that you can't even see because you are stuck in a petrified point of view of someone. When you're loyal to your soul, you begin to see, I am not here to change anyone. I am here to shift my own perception that I may see rightly, not to set things rightly, but to see it rightly. And if I see it rightly, things come into harmony with the way that I am seeing. As I was saying in the earlier service, there was a young lady who was about to get married, very nervous, knees shaking, thought she was going to faint. And she's telling the minister, you know, I don't know if I can walk down this aisle without fainting. I don't know if I can do it. I'm nervous. And he said, listen, you have certain landmarks that you'll look at, that, and you when you look at this landmark, it'll keep you in the present, stable. You walk down the aisle. He said, the first landmark is the aisle itself. You notice that you're going to walk, and you're going to turn, and you're going to walk down the aisle. And then to your right, you're getting closer to the front. There's the changing room. So you look. You said, the changing room. You know you're almost there. And then there's the hymnal right in front. And so she said, okay, the aisle, the changing room, the hymnal, okay. So she's doing it nicely and beautifully. And she gets to the front, and her fiancé's parents hear her saying, I'll change him. I'll change him. And you know, many people live their lives that way. I'll change him. I'll change her. I'll change them. And they get stuck in a petrified view of themselves, and they get stuck in a petrified view of the other individual. When you understand that there are states of consciousness. I remember at a Wednesday night service a few years ago, I was speaking, and suddenly I could see the thought forms that were thinking through people. The people weren't thinking the thoughts were thinking them. And they looked like they were puppets on the string of these thoughts coming through, you see. You will begin to see states of consciousness have people's attention. and just moving through the world. It's not even them. It's just what they've been captured by, the news. They're captured by the media. They're captured by false teachings. They're captured by superstition. they're captured by all manner of things, and they think they're living life, but they're just living thought forms and perceptions and beliefs moving through them, and then the egoic perception seeks to protect that particular perception because the ego doesn't know anything outside of that, and then they end up defending that particular perception, that particular point of view, and then they become a fundamentalist to that particular point of view, you see, because they're afraid that what's outside is annihilation when it's actually freedom, you see? So such a time as this, when the world is going through many changes, and I dare say this is the best time on planet Earth ever. Ever. This is the best time. There's less violence on the planet any time in human history, one. It's the best time because the Earth is vibrating at a higher frequency than it's ever existed, based on the measurement of the last 30 years from scientists, but hundreds of years by shaman that know how to measure that intuitively. So the Earth is vibrating at a much higher capacity. There's more and more people meditating. There's billions of people now that know what meditation is, that knows what life visioning is, know what affirmative prayer is, that know what metaphysics is. And many people are practicing that at an all-time high. So there is an expansion of this awareness. Now, our awareness, we're becoming more aware of our expanded nature. And then because of that, there's some dissolution. There's dissolution and dissolution. In other words, there is stuff rising to the surface that no longer fit in that high frequency, and it's causing a lot of chaos, you see. But we know in the chaos theory that underneath chaos is actually an underlying order that's seeking to emerge. So we call it chaotic, a chaos that order is underlying that particular chaos. All of this is going on in the world of phenomena right now. How did you translate chaotic? That just crossed my mind as I'm thinking about it. Anyway, I know I'm speaking fast, but you know. Anyway, let me slow down for the interpreters. So all of this is going on. So for the casual observer, it seems like, oh my God, there's so much negativity happening. But oh no, life always wins. And your role, not only to not petrify individuals into whatever state they're in, but you're also not to petrify the world into a sense of negativity. You are to begin to see the state, it's called the beloved community, the state, kind to just global society, the state, all needs met for all people, the state, loving kindness, health care, food, shelter, education, safety. You're to begin to see that state of consciousness beginning in your imagination and then hearing the call of the genuine within you so that you're actually feeling that, so that you're carrying that in your awareness, you see. So then you will be a part of the harbingers that are birthing the world that God sees. Remember, all you need is a little tiny bit. You know, think of the grain, the seed of the mustard tree. Think of that. Small seed, big tree. Infinitesimal awareness of something to celebrate, something that's of beauty and of love and of harmony, until that's all that you see. You're not denying there's stuff going on the planet, but it is within your field of expanded awareness of the isness and the nowness and the allness of the spirit of the living God. And then all heaven breaks free. All heaven breaks loose. Hell too. You know, hell means stagnation. But it starts to quicken itself. So we're in a very high state of consciousness right now. It's called confusion. Confusion is a very high state of consciousness because it means that the birthing of the new is happening simultaneously with the decadent, the old dying. And the decadent has plans for years in advance as to how it's going to control and manipulate. But it always loses. Throughout history, no dictator has lasted forever. No nefarious movement has ever lasted. Nothing that's outside of the integrity of the universe stands, regardless of how technologically advanced it may be or how smart people are. Life wins. So you, when to be loyal to your soul. Loyalty to your soul. And the values of what an eternal deathless, birthless, timeless being that carries the full imprimatur of the Christ presence is about. And then you will not be dangling from the strings of others' agendas. You won't be just walking around with unabated fear and worry. No. You'll be walking around with a supernal confidence. That the universe is progressive. Remember Einstein's question? He said that one of the most important questions you can ever ask is the universe friendly? And once you understand that it's progressive, doesn't work against itself, then you can walk boldly in time, bringing the eternal as you're loyal to your own soul. Pre-incarnational choice. Seeing states without judgment, using your imagination to see the higher state that's trying to emerge and talk to it. Do an experiment. Just take someone and begin to see the higher order of being that's trying to emerge and talk to it until that's what you see. And then watch as you assist in the quickening of that unfoldment. But you're going to get it first. When you lift your awareness, you're going to get it first. And you're going to see your own blind spots without judgment and embrace your own liberation and freedom. So hear this, hear it. You are the alchemist of your own life. You take a little bit of gold to turn lead to gold. You take what looks like a little bit of joy, a little bit of something to be grateful for, a little bit of something to celebrate, a little bit of something that's beautiful. You place your attention there. You work with it. You fan that spark until it becomes a flame. And then you see as God sees. And God only sees quality, does not see quantity, because God is infinite and everywhere present, cannot know quantity because it's everything already. There's nothing outside of it. And then you begin to have glimpses of what God sees and the way God sees. Whew. And then you'll walk with a deep and abiding loyalty to your soul, the soul faculty being activated. And you won't walk with the awareness of I'll change them. You walk with the awareness of I see them. I see. The state, and I see the real being. This is work. It's real work. It's deep. You got to go deep in this, okay? And then you'll be a joyful participant in the energy that's flowing. Remember, you won't live any longer anticipating good coming from afar. When you start to work with the quality, you are participating. You become a participant, not an anticipant. The kingdom of heaven's at hand now. The ground upon which you're standing is holy now. God is here now. God is an is system. God is a now system. God is now. Here it is. Here it is. And then you'll find yourself in the frequency of celebration. You'll be seeing God as dancer throughout all of nature. The leaves and the trees, the grass, the ground, the earth pulsating, the Watch this being. Watch this being. Watch this being.
Your life is changed. Your life is changed.
This is the family of Charlotte Clayton.
You want to hear the whole thing? You know how to get it. You know
how to get it. They got their agape going on right there in the kitchen while they're doing arts and crafts and singing and dancing, getting that frequency and that vibration all in their soul. What about you? It's time for you to get up and move your groove thing until your groove is a groove of unfoldment. A groove of generosity, a groove of love, a groove of health and harmony and wholeness. Oh, and when you do this, oh, nothing can stop you because there's nothing outside of you to stop you. Everything is a perception and a projection of that perception onto the world. Ain't no stopping us now. Come on.
There's been so many things that's held us down, but now it looks like things are finally coming around. I know we've got a long, long way to go, and where we'll end up, I don't know. But we won't let nothing hold us back. We're gonna put ourselves together. We're gonna polish up our rag. And if you ever been held down before, you're trying to make it, they only push you aside. They really ain't got nowhere to go. Ask them where they're going.
They don't know.
But we won't let nothing hold us back. We're gonna put ourselves together. We're gonna polish up our rack. Well, if you've ever been held down before, I know you refuse to be held down anymore.
Got the victory.
Ain't no stopping us now. We got the
stomping us now. Oh, just hit that part in your chest, that thymus, and just say, ain't nothing stopping me. I'm one with God, I'm healthy. I'm one with God, I'm wealthy. I'm one with God, I'm beautiful. I'm one with God, I'm magnificent. I'm one with God, I reveal the love of the universe. I'm one with God, everything is working together for my good. Ain't nothing stopping us. There is nothing to stop us. Outside of our limited perception, there's nothing but God everywhere. And so we feel into that. Let us feel into that. Nothing can stop us. Feel into that. Feel the great sense of celebratory gratitude. The sense of celebratory thankfulness and dynamic appreciation. And this dynamic appreciation, oh, it clears our perceptual windows. And we begin to notice, oh my God, this God is everywhere. Miracles everywhere. There's good things that are happening. Wow, I didn't notice it before. It's everywhere. We begin to see with new eyes. And in seeing with new eyes, we recognize the presence. Oh, in this dynamic recognition factor, we feel our oneness with God. Oh, this is not blasphemy. Blasphemy is to limit God. We want to magnify God. As Mother Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord. We're not blaspheming God by saying we're one with God. We're magnifying God. We're the magnifiers of the present. In this moment of sincere magnification, the word is spoken for each and every one of us, that divine freedom, spiritual coherence, wellness and well-being, safety, divine security, all needs met. Oh, this cascades out of nothing, out of no thing. Yet it's now becoming the very somethingness of our life. It's a beautiful manifestation of let there be consciousness. A beautiful manifestation of in the beginning consciousness. In the beginning, it's not in the beginning problem. It's not in the beginning obstacle. In the beginning, there was an issue. In the beginning, there was lack and limitation. No, 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 no. In the beginning, God. And God did not birth the entire cosmos and the magnificent multidimensional universe out of loneliness. God didn't say, oh, I'm lonely, I need. No, no, no. God said, I'm celebrating myself. I'm fulfilled and overflowing with so much good, I've got to burst into expression and manifestation. And so we do the same. In the beginning, God, in the beginning, love, in the beginning, beauty. Bursting onto the scene as through the power of this word for each and every individual listening right now, that their life may be made new. I hear it. Behold, I make all things new. Behold, I make all things new. Behold, I make all things new. Oh, it's happening now. Receive it. Receive it. Receive it. Be loyal to your soul and the genius that's within you. Receive it. And let health and harmony and wholeness reign supreme in your life right now. I speak the word for this. I call the name of this congregation out. And as I'm speaking the word about them, I know that where they are, God is in God's fullness, and that every organ, action, function of their being is made every whit whole, that the harmonizing prosperity reigns supreme in their life, and that wisdom and guidance flow through them in a language in a way that they can understand, and that they are safe as they are cradled by the presence that is never an absence. This is what I see. This is what I give thanks for. The love presence, the love presence, the love presence is having its way with us right now. Feel into this, feel into this.
trust love. Trust God. That love is everywhere. And we all are here to be the perfect givers of love and receivers of love, and love will have the final word. No one ever loses when one trusts love, 'cause love is something that will not ever fail. Love is the essence of the Spirit that is known by always giving. Love only sees the truth beyond the appearance that is showing. Love judges not, and love renews. Yes, love renews. Love is a healer. Oh, yes, it is. Love loves to love. Love loves to love. And we'll keep on being love. Oh, we'll keep on being love. It is it. Love.
Why don't you lean on love?
Lean on love.
Lean on love. Trust God. Are you smiling with the awareness that you can trust in the invisible presence of love and of peace and of harmony and wholeness and abundance? Do so now.